Well, good morning.
Good morning.
Maybe the first thing that you can do is tell me your name.
My name is Brian Gray.
And you are, of course, here. We are here, of course, at Rudolf Steiner College in California. And maybe you can tell me a little bit first about the history of the college.
Rudolf Steiner College was founded in 1976. Really, it came together out of a group of people who were interested in the work of Carl Stegman, as well as the work of Rudolf Steiner. And Carl Stegman had written a book called The Other America, which was really trying to say, what is the spiritual mission of America? And many of the people involved were also connected with the world of education, and with the Waldorf School itself, which had, the Sacramento Waldorf School had been founded. So several people had gotten to know Carl and his wife, Christine Stegman. And they were living in Oakland at that time, and they couldn't find a circle to study with in Oakland, but in Sacramento there was this very interested group of people. So on February 22nd, 1976, Carl Stegman came here, which happened to be, of course, the bicentennial year and the Washington's birthday in 1976, and sat with a circle of people and said to them, if you are really serious about this, Christine and I will move from Oakland and we'll come to Sacramento and we'll start a center to study the mission of America and bring the work of Rudolf Steiner to life here in the West.
Wow.
And it was a kind of a Whitson event. It was a very exciting moment in their lives. And then he went around very practically, what will you do, what will you do, what will you do? And Betty Staley was involved and Franklin Kane, Nancy Poor. A number of people who are still connected with the college were the founders of that institute. So initially it had two basic interests, to study the work of the mission of America, spiritual mission of America, in the light of Rudolf Steiner's research and Carl Stegman's work, and then also to bring Waldorf education more fully into the teacher education.
Yes.
So that was the founding impulse.
And were the other colleges there at that point, like the one in New York?
I'm not actually sure.
Maybe that was Detroit.
I think it was in Detroit. It was at Mercy College in Detroit. And actually, Carl Stegman and that circle of people, for the first year, no one was paid a salary. Everyone worked voluntarily.
Wow.
Christine Stegman donated her savings to make it, to basically pay the expenses. And the small campus here was just 2 acres at that point in time. The small campus was designated, and it was all run by gift and sacrifice. And then the second year of the college, they had recognized Rene Carrido was one of the charismatic teachers who they brought in to teach, and they recognized immediately that Rene had a gift. For attracting people and for conveying the enthusiasm. So Rene was then hired in 1977, and he became very rapidly the director of Rudolf Steiner. At that time, it was called the Sacramento Center for Anthroposophical Studies. And then in 1979, the name was changed to Rudolf Steiner College.
When did you then?
I came in 1979, so I came 3 years after the founding and 2 years after Rene had begun. And I came as a student. I was very interested in the work of Rudolf Steiner. I didn't intend to be a Waldorf teacher, but I really wanted to ground myself in the study of anthroposophy, the study of Rudolf Steiner's work. And I had a background in architecture and environmental planning and landscape architecture and in the arts, music, and so forth, and was working in those fields up in Seattle when I discovered Rudolf Steiner. And I also had a young child, so I wanted to come down and learn about anthroposophy. And I thought, I was living on Orcas Island up in Washington State, and I thought, well, it'd be healthy to, and we were trying to get a fledgling school started, so I thought, I'll come down and study and bring the fruit of my study back to Orcas Island and help ground this impulse. But when I got here and met Rene, Rene was such a charismatic and dynamic teacher that I was really, I was very amazed and impressed by what he was conveying. Tremendous enthusiasm, tremendous knowledge, a wonderful lecturer, a wonderful human being, and radiant and enthusiastic, and a man of the world as well. Incredible cultural savvy, he spoke 5 languages and knew everybody and traveled widely. And so I became really, I recognized also that Rene was 20 years older than I was, and that at some point Rene would would not, Renee wouldn't be here forever, yeah. and that someone would need to pick up the threads.
Exactly, exactly.
And so I sat at his feet for the first year and listened and took millions of notes. And then I decided to come back and do the teacher training year and not begin because I wanted to be a teacher. It really was the only other program available at that
yeah,
point.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So I did the teacher training, the Walter Teacher Training Program. And in fact was tempted to become a Waldorf teacher, but I realized that really I wanted to work with adults. I wanted to bring anthroposophy and anthroposophical studies to the fore. So I was playing, I had already started playing piano for Eurythmy classes and was working with Stuart Buck, who was the architect, and we were beginning to do the master plan and build buildings. We built, designed and built Philadelphia Hall and other structures. So, and the campus had expanded to 3 acres and we had big plans. So there, I felt invited, I felt welcome, and Renee was very encouraging. And so basically after I finished, Renee said, what are you going to do? I said, well, I'd like to work, I'd like to stay here. And he said, we'd love you to stay here. And so I lived on campus for 8 years in a little shack on the campus and and helped build the college, basically. So I've been here since, I've been here for 33 years now.
That's an amazing.
Yes, it is. And I absolutely love it. I mean, this is
I can tell. I saw you at the lecture last night. You know, it was it was wonderful. Now, tell me, in your own, because, you know, anthroposophy is always that you come in with a certain destiny.
Yes.
For instance, can you see anything in your childhood that sort of prepared you and as a young man to take up the work of Rudolf Steiner in the first place?
That's a good question. My parents were, I actually told my parents, I was the middle of the third of five children. I was born in Chicago. We ended up living in southern Mississippi because my father got a job with Masonite Corporation in the south. And so I'd had a taste of the north, living in Chicago for 7 years and living in the deep south in Mississippi and going through high school there and then went to Georgia Tech and got an architecture degree. But as a child, I really felt, my mother was a very devout Catholic, and my father only became a, he was not nominally a Catholic, but he supported the children and came to Mass with us and so forth. So there was a very, there was a very strong devotional element in my childhood, which I'm very grateful for. And my mother played the piano, and my older brother, Paul, was a wonderful artist, a graphic artist, and so I was stimulated by all the art that was happening in the family. And I, so as I was growing up, I thought, well, I'm either going to be an artist or I'm going to be a musician. And so when I told my parents that, they said, well, you're not going to make a living at either of those.
Right.
You need something that will support you.
So
I was in my senior year in high school, and I was driving past, riding past an architect's office, and I looked at the plaque, and I saw the building, and I said, "Architecture, that's practical art. That's art which has a music, because architecture is frozen music." I'd somehow heard that phrase, so architecture is something. So I all of a sudden I was became more and more interested in architecture. So and in my study of then when I went to Georgia Tech, in the architecture history classes that I was taking, there was one slide of the Gurdjieff, of Rudolf Steiner's building. Dornach, and it was very quickly brushed aside as amateurish. And
you mean you actually came across that?
I did. I came across a picture of Rudolf Steiner's building.
Wow.
In architecture history, but it was one slide, and it was just basically yes, and there was a strange thing happening. Next slide, you know.
And it was gone.
But I was stimulated. There was something there that clicked. So, but I, I was actually 30. When I the first time I read something, the first book I read was The Fifth Gospel by Rudolf Steiner. I read it when I was 32 years old, and it really changed my life. I was going through a very difficult time, and so that book really changed me tremendously. And then I read the lectures called The Spiritual Hierarchies. I also was interested in astrology from
yes,
a young age and
yes,
the stars.
Yes.
So all these things, I'd been practicing astrology for 10 years. And all of a sudden, here's Rudolf Steiner's insights that help understand the stars and architecture and the arts. And so I do feel that I have, that my destiny is connected with his work, no question about it. But it was, I was a sleepy child in the sense of I wasn't completely awake to what was, to all these different streams that were flowing. But as I look back, there certainly is a wisdom in
And also what parents you come to.
That's right, absolutely, yes. My parents were very, very supportive, and they always, I mean, I really feel blessed. I've never really had a job that I couldn't tolerate or that I didn't, in fact, find great pleasure and joy in doing.
Mm-hmm.
And I've worked for very low wages for many years, but but I love the work. I mean, what I do is
well, it comes through when you lecture, that's for sure.
Incredibly nourishing.
You know, maybe you can tell me a little bit more about the astrosophy and how you got into that, because, you know, there's a group of you, as far as I understand.
There is a group of us working together. There's five, I have four colleagues that work regularly together. William Bento is a dear friend, and he's been doing star work for a number of years. We all came into astrology somewhere in the 70s, and Robert Chippikasi was also living nearby. He was living in the Bay Area when I came here. And so I met William and Robert, and they'd been studying with Uli Zucker up in Meadow Vista near Auburn.
Mm-hmm.
And Robert Powell is a deep, was also a student of Uli Zucker, and he was getting he was a mathematician who was then getting a degree in astronomy as well. So he was very interested, continues to be very interested and very productive in star work. And then David Tresmer, we met David Tresmer in Boulder. David Tresmer had built a 12-sided building up in the foothills.
The
Star House in Boulder. And so the five of us have been working together for quite a while. And all of us have some background in astrology. But all of us are really interested in the Christ impulse very strongly. And Rudolf Steiner had spoken how the Christ impulse, if one were to look at the Christ as the Christ moved through the earth and performed the deeds that he was performing, that all of the Christ deeds were in fact reflecting the activities of the starry worlds. That there's a definite relationship between the starry worlds, the cosmic world, and the earthly world.
And as is in agriculture.
That's right, as in agriculture.
You know,
as well.
People forget that.
Yes.
You know,
and so, and of course, Rudolf Steiner's picture of cosmology, that it goes back even stronger than the idea as above, so below. But the spiritual world, the spiritual beings living in the starry worlds, have provided the earth as a framework for us to become spirits of freedom and love.
Yeah.
And yet, the wisdom of the earth and the wisdom of our lives is deeply connected with the rhythms and patterns of starry worlds. So there's a deep connection. And the more I studied astrology and the more I studied human biography, I realized that there are certain events that happen in life which are archetypal for everybody. Rudolf Steiner speaks about the change of teeth. Everybody changes their teeth somewhere, 6, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9.
Yes.
But there are definite biographical events that one can find correlations to star events.
Mm-hmm.
How the birth chart, and he gives us a picture that the birth chart, of course, is the garment which we wear along with our physical body and etheric body and astral body. Our ego comes in and bears the impression of the stars at the moment of our birth. They're actually impressed etherically into our brain. And our whole way of viewing the world is deeply connected with the moment of our birth. And we continue to, of course, we're always adding to that picture. So that was more or less a confirmation of the significance of star wisdom and astrology. I was also very stimulated and continue to be stimulated by the idea that Rudolf Steiner said that the earth itself is formed by the cosmos. And just as our entire organism is a picture of a reflection of the stars, that the earth is a living organism, is the microcosm reflecting the starry world. So for many years I've been studying, actually for almost 1980 I came across a passage that suggested certain star alignments over the earth might have some significance. And so I've been doing that work research for many, many years as well, and have come to some significant, found wonderful correlations. Mm-hmm. Between the heavens and the geography of the earth is something I've been studying for 32 years as well.
Yeah.
So there's
also a correlation between your work and the work of